Good evening. Can you guys hear me all right? Yes? Okay. Now, give me a second. We just got in the classroom. We got locked out again. So. Was there a webcam in front of that computer last time you were here?
No, there wasn't.
Really? Mm-hmm. Did it just disappear at some point?
I turned it back into you.
Oh, okay. Thank you. You can just leave it connected if you want.
I got it.
Hopefully they won't.
Thank you.
Let me take attendance real quick and then we'll get started. So a couple things I want to just go over real quickly before we start, or before I start, is what's going on in the next couple weeks. So as you're aware, probably in some of your other classes, this is midterms. Actually, last week was midterms week for the college. Some of the midterm grading was moved back just because we had been closed for a week prior to that. And so typically right around the mid part of the quarter, we'll have test one. And what we're going to do, we will have the test. It'll be comprised of two parts, a take-home essay part and an in-class portion, which we'll do next week. And I'll, at the end of class, I'll cover what those will be over and tell you when you should expect to see those. But essentially the midterm, the in-class portion of the midterm will cover chapters 1 through 3, which is what we've been doing in class up to this point. And the take-home essay questions will revolve around the tribal taxation and legal resources that we covered last week. that we discussed in class prior to getting to the financial statements at the end of class. So my plan is to have the take-home essay questions posted to Canvas by Friday, by the end of the week. And you will then have until Tuesday to complete the essay questions on those tribal legal and taxation resources. And then during class next Tuesday, we'll have basically, it'll be a very short tests, including multiple choice and true, false, and fill in the blank and things like that on materials from chapters 1 through 3. And I'll schedule 30 minutes for that. So we'll only spend 30 minutes of the class time on that. And we'll spend the rest on working on some of the ratios in chapter 4 that we're moving into tonight. So that's sort of the plan right now for the next couple weeks. I also wanted to let you know that I got through some grading basically through the second week of the quarter. So if you didn't receive a notice today, I did this afternoon literally, check Canvas and you should have a grade. On some of the chapter one questions, several of you missed, for instance, questions 1-7 and 1-8. The assignment was to do questions 1-6 through 1-9. And then 111 and 112. And I think some of you just thought it was 16 and 19 along with 111 and 112. So check your Canvas. And if you missed those, you should see a comment there with that. Another thing I'll just make a comment on after grading is that even if you find the answer to a question directly from the book, do not quote it directly from a book. You need to put all of your narrative answers in your own words. And there were a couple questions specifically in chapter one that it was real obvious people just put down the answer directly from the book. But you need to put it in your own words. Even if you cite it with these assignments, you need to actually articulate it in your own words. So that's just a note sort of moving forward. So respond to any of those comments that I left on your assignments if you missed something out, and then once you've resubmitted your assignment with the missing questions, then I'll grade it at that point. And since we are at the midpoint of the quarter, the other thing that happens in this class is that at the point of the first midterm, which will be next Tuesday, you need to have basically all your assignments caught up to that point. And if you haven't, then they won't be worth anything after that. So if you're missing assignments from chapter one or chapter two, or basically anything that was assigned that's due up until today, you need to get that done by next Tuesday if you want credit. One of the reasons I do this is because really doing those assignments is preparing you to take the first test number one. And so if you haven't done them already, then it's going to be pretty, it's not going to be very useful for you. Because you won't have prepared for the for that first test. And so so if you have late homework, if you have assignments that you haven't turned in yet or need to complete some additional questions on, get those turned in by next Tuesday, basically 5 p.m. at class for credit. I don't think anyone's turned in all the assignments yet, so I'm probably safe on that.
I have a question.
Yep.
For last week's assignment, you said you were going to update it on Canvas, and I was waiting for that, and I didn't find it, so I went back to the video of last week's class.
Yep.
And you stated to do questions 3-3 and 3-7, and then the rest would be a written assignment, and so I haven't seen any of that, not unless you posted it today, which I haven't viewed yet.
Right. No, I didn't. I didn't change the assignment. What I did was I moved the assignment due date back. So the complete assignment for chapter three is not due until next week, because we'll work on basically the last two financial statements tonight, the statement of cash flows and statement of stockholders equity, which you'll need to know to complete that assignment. So, so that entire assignment, I just moved back a week so that we had covered all of that material in class. And so if you submit it by the 28th, then essentially it'll be on time.
So what I did view on Canvas, those other white questions to ask are to answer them.
I haven't graded any of chapter three, so I couldn't tell you. I can look at that if you want, but you need to send me an email that remind me to do that.
Yeah, because I went back to the video, like I said, and then it said only to do 3-3 and 3-7, and the rest of it was going to be a written assignment.
Yeah, no, what I intended to do was part of it would be due today, the ones that we covered, the income statement and the balance sheet, and the rest would be new next week. I just decided to push everything until next week. So if you do the same assignment have it turned in by next week after we cover the rest of the financial statements tonight, then you'll be fine for those chapter three problems. Does that make sense?
Well, are you going to post that then? Because I have a forgetful mind also.
Oh, it's already posted. Yeah, the due date was updated. So the assignment didn't change at all. It's the same four problems that were there. I just moved the due date back a week so that we covered everything in class before it was actually due by you.
Okay, thank you.
That makes sense, yep. So what we're going to finish off in chapter three tonight, as I said, are the statement of cash flows and the statement of stockholders' equity. And after we've gone through those two financial statements, then we'll have reviewed everything, which, again, hopefully you remember somewhat from financial accounting, BUED 212. And then you can complete the chapter three problems. And I will tell you, too, if you haven't started those problems, leave extra time, because even after we go through these reviews of the financial statements, they are still challenging. So don't expect that you're going to get these four problems done in less than an hour, I would say. You're probably going to spend an hour or two needing to work on those to figure them out. So the other thing I'll say about chapter three homework is that the best way to do those problems is to just create a real abbreviated financial statement with the information that you get and then fill in the blanks. So if it's asking you about an income statement, some item on an income statement, then you should use the information that they give you in that problem to create just a real basic income statement. And based on that, you'll be able to find out the missing information that they're asking for you. If you don't create one of these many financial statements, whether it's an income statement, a balance sheet, or a statement of cash flows, it's going to be really, really difficult for you to find the right answer. And in fact, I think it would be pretty much impossible. So that's my recommendation for these problems. They are challenging problems. Certainly students have expressed that in the past. And so the best way I can tell you to work on these is just to create a simple financial statement based on what they're asking you and then figure out what needs to go where from there.
We do that on Excel?
Yeah, Excel's the best. That way it calculates it for you. If you have
so like say for cash flow, we got to type in there cash flow or write down the figure.
Well, you need to look at the table, the figure in the book that shows you how a cash flow statement looks like and what all the components to it are, and then take the information that they give you in the problem and put that into that same format. Yeah.
So that whole sheet we got to recreate.
Well, you're not going to be given all of that information, but you will need to, I'm going to go through that right now. You will need to create a statement of cash flows. Yeah, with the four different categories in there. Definitely. That's the hard one. They're all difficult, but that's the hard one. So, like I said, make sure you have a good amount, leave yourself a good amount of time to do these because they're not quick problems. All right, so tonight we're basically going to be finishing off those last two financial statements in Chapter 3, and then we're going to be moving on to Chapter 4 and looking at, the financial ratios and calculations that we're going to start working on in Chapters 4 and 5. So that's the plan for tonight. Anybody else have any questions? No? Okay. So if you want to bring up, if you want to bring up Canvas, we're going to be looking at 5. Mm-hmm. And the tables that we're going to start out with are tables 3-3 under resources, tables 3-3 through 3-6. That's what we're going to be looking at right now.
Okay, I'm so sorry. Can you tell me how to get to Canvas again while you're on the screen?
If you go to nwic.edu.
But I don't have any icons to open up a new browser.
If you're in full screen, then you'll need to minimize that.
Oh, is that what I do? Okay.
Yeah, if your Zoom is in full screen, then you're not going to see anything else.
Okay, there we go.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So let me share my screen here. Okay. So table 3-3 is essentially the statement of cash flows for Allied Food Products for 2011. This is the same company, the same year that we went over for the income statement and the balance sheet. So this is using the same financials from that year to create this statement of cash flows. So real briefly, one of the things I'll say is if you notice here, there are letters next to each of these rows, right? A, B, A through T, basically. Right below that, there are a line by line explanation of what's going on in each of these rows. So I'm going to cover this briefly, but after I cover this tonight or tomorrow, I'd highly recommend that you go through this one again on your own and look at these different notes and read exactly what's going on to refresh it for yourself, because you'll need to understand this again to do the chapter 3 problem that has to do with the statement of cash flows.
Okay, sir?
Yes.
Okay, I'm in Canvas. Where do I go from there to?
Week number 5 and tables 3-3 through 3-6. So, yeah, this week is week number 5. So all the resources we're going to be using tonight are from week number 5.
Is that what you have up on screen right now?
Yes. Yep. Yeah, and you'll find it in your book on page 69, if it's the 7th edition.
I don't see anything on the screen.
You don't see my screen?
Well, I went to 3-3 to 3-6 and clicked on it, and there's, what am I supposed to be seeing? Because I don't see anything.
You should be seeing what's on my screen right now. You can just follow along on my screen if you're having problems bringing it up. So.
Well, I can't even see your screen.
I'm not really sure how to help you. I would try Alt-Tab. You need to be able to move between these windows. So yeah, use Alt-Tab to.
Okay, I got you now.
I'm up. All right. So I'm going to go through these line by line real briefly here, just to explain what's going on, and we'll talk about these. So the statement of cash flows is organized into 4 different sections. And the 4 different sections are the different ways in which the operations of a business or the investing of a business or the financing activities of a business can impact cash flow. So that's how they're organized here. We start with operating activities. We go to long-term investing activities, financing activities, and then the summary. I know people are sending me notes right now. I can't read those while I'm going through this. So if you have a question about this, please verbally ask me. I can't, it's difficult for me to go back and forth between the two. So I can answer your questions at break. But if you have a question about this right now, just ask verbally. All right, so the operating activities, it all starts with net income. because that's where a company in the long run is going to make money and make cash, have a positive impact on the cash flow. And so what a cash flow statement essentially measures is the flow of money in and out of a business. So as money comes into the business through sales, through payments on receivables, and money goes out of a business to pay bills and other expenses, then obviously the cash flow goes up and down. And so what a cash flow statement will tell you is in a particular, usually year, and so this is for 2011, what the impact of these different areas, these operating activities, investing activities, and financing activities had on the cash flow for the business. And it can be both positive and negative, as I just explained. So one of the things to note here as we go through, anything that's in brackets like this 200 here is a negative. So you don't necessarily need to see a negative sign in front of this. Anything that's in brackets like this, you should also understand as being a negative number. So so I'm going to start up here with the operating activities and just move down through this statement of cash flows. So the net income for the year was $117.5 million. They made money. That's positive. So that contributes positively, 117.5 in income to the business. C, depreciation and amortization. That comes in as a positive 100 million. And that's because depreciation expense, which is things like when you buy a building or you buy a piece of equipment that's going to last for multiple years, you don't recognize the expense all in the first year, right? So if you buy a building and you expect it to last for 30 years, you're going to depreciate that building off over 30 years. So you're going to expense it out over 30 years. That doesn't mean that you actually are making a cash payment on it. It just means that's the depreciation expense for that asset. So it's a non-cash expense. So because of that, because it doesn't impact your cash flow in a negative way, it's added back to your cash flow. So depreciation and amortization expense of $100 million is added back there. It's a positive $100 million.
Can it be partially subtracted, like say a quarter?
No, depreciation expense will be fully added back to cash flow activities because it's a non-cash expense. There's no cash going out for these types of expenses. You've already spent it.
After 1 year?
No, you depreciate it over multiple years. So this is just for 2011, but it's depreciating expenses for multiple years on these assets. So
since it's 2011, it won't be depreciated until the following years.
No, this is the depreciation expense that actually occurred during 2011. And so that's being added back into the cash flow. Again, this is a non-cash expense, and so that's why we're adding it back into the cash. Because we didn't actually, even though it's an expense and it comes off of our income statement, the company didn't pay any actual cash, or at least the equivalent of that in 2011. All right, inventory. So they are showing a negative $200 million in inventories based on an increase in inventories. So the reason that's negative is because their inventory amount increased by a certain amount by this $200 million compared to 2010. And so to acquire that inventory, they obviously had to spend $200 million to get that increased level of inventory. So that's a negative impact on cash flow when you increase inventories. The opposite happens when a company decreases inventories from year to year. If they have, say, $30 million less in inventory in 2011 than 2010, then that would actually be a positive $30 million there. So that's just based on a change in inventories from year to year. That impact. We have increase in accounts receivable, which means in 2011, the accounts receivable was $60 million more than in 2010. And so because it's more, that means more people, more customers owe the company money, right? The accounts receivable balance went up by $60 million between 2010 and 2011. So that means there's an additional $60 million that they didn't collect on sales yet, that they will in the future, but they haven't yet. And so that amount needs to be reflected as a negative in the cash flow statement, because they've sold those items, but they haven't received the cash yet for those items. So that's a negative impact on the cash flow statement. F, we have an increase in accounts payable. So from 2010 to 2011, their accounts payable balance went up by $30 million. And that's recorded as an increase in cash flow. And that's because, think about it this way, if the purchases that they made in 2011, if they bought $30 million more on account, that means they haven't paid for it yet, right? Their accounts payable, the amount that they owe other companies for the supplies and equipment that they purchased, they have $30 million more in payables than they did the previous year. And so they haven't paid for it yet. So that's a positive impact on cash flow of $30 million. It will be a negative impact once they pay for it, but as of right now, 2011, they haven't. And so you reflect any increases in accounts payable as an increase in cash flow too. And G is an increase in accrued wages and taxes. And that is reflected by a positive $10 million impact on the cash flow statement. So sort of like accounts payable, accrued wages and taxes are also called wages payable and taxes payable. So if we increase the amounts in any of our payable accounts, whether it's just straight up accounts payable or wages payable or taxes payable, that means that we haven't paid that. We owe it, but we haven't paid it yet. And so because we haven't paid it, that has a positive impact on the cash flow statement in the amount of $10 million there.
So how is there a difference between wages and payable?
I'm sorry, can you restate that?
How is there a difference between wages and payable?
They're calling this accrued wages, and accrued wages are the same as wages payable. They're wages that have been earned by the employee but not yet paid. So it's like, you know, if you're in the middle of a payroll cycle and you've worked 2 weeks but as an employee have yet to get paid, the company still owes you that, but yeah. So accrued wages and accrued taxes are also called wages payable or taxes payable too. You can think about that the same way. And then here, so basically all of these operating activities then on line H here are totaled up. So if you add all of these numbers up here from 117.5 down to 10 million, you'll come up with negative 2.5 million in cash flow from operating activities. So they actually lost a little bit of money just based on their operating activities in 2011.
That's subtracting the 200 and the 60?
Yeah. Yeah, those are negatives. Yep. So, they actually had a slightly negative cash flow just from operating activities during 2011 there. Okay. So, the second section in the cash flow statement is termed long-term investing activities. Excuse me. And these are activities where the company buys large assets like pieces of land, maybe a building, large pieces of equipment, things like that. These would be considered your long-term assets or your fixed assets, a property, plant, and equipment. And so any addition, so they had $230 million more in property, plant, and equipment at the end of 2011 than they did at the start of 2011. So this 230, because they added that amount of equipment, they obviously had to pay for it in some fashion. And so we'll assume, until we get down to the next section, financing activities, that they just paid out of pocket for it. So if they paid out of pocket for $230 million worth of property, plant, and equipment, then that's a $230 million negative impact on the cash flow statement. they had to come up with those funds from somewhere, right? And so that's the only entry here in long-term investing activities. And so the impact from long-term investing activities on the cash flow is negative $230 million, quite a bit. So far, it's not looking too great for this company from a cash flow perspective. When we get down here to the third section of financing activities, we see probably how they paid for, how Allied Food Products paid for some of those additions to their property, plant, and equipment. Because in line M here, they have an increase in notes payable. And that means that they increased the amount of short-term loans. Notes payable are loans for less than a year's time. So they increased their loans, their short-term loans or their notes payable by $50 million. This has a positive impact on cash flow. They're getting $50 million in the form of loan from a financial institution or somewhere. But that's a positive impact. They're signing a promissory note and saying, yes, we're going to pay this back in less than a year or in a year's time, whatever it is. And in exchange for that promissory note, they get $50 million. So that's a positive $50 million impact on cash flow.
What about interest?
Interest expense is included in your net income because that comes out, that's an expense that comes out on that income statement. And so that's interest expenses reflected there. So this is just the amount that they received in loans, in short-term loans, notes payable. In line N, they have increases in bonds outstanding. So the bonds are the more long-term loans. So maybe they sold 5-year bonds or 10-year bonds or 15-year bonds to be able to purchase some of this property, plant, and equipment up here. And so they increased the number of bonds outstanding by $170 million. So at this point, my take on it, if you ask me how they acquired $230 million of additional property, plant, and equipment, they added $50 million in short-term notes payable, and then they added another $170 million in bonds payable. So that would total $220 million through those two financing activities, which is right pretty darn close to the $230 they had here that they added to their property, plant, and equipment. So that's likely what they did to be able to purchase the majority of that property, plant, and equipment is to essentially finance more via notes payable and bonds payable. And then the other financing activity in line O here is payment of dividends to stockholders. So if you remember last week, we saw that the company in 2011 had a net income of 117.5, and they decided to distribute 57.5 of that back to shareholders in the form of dividends. That's how that's one of the ways in which shareholders make money or income from owning a stock. And so because the company decided to distribute that amount back to shareholders, that's a negative impact on cash flow. So that's negative $57.5 million due to the payment of dividends to stockholders. And so the sum of the financing activities, finally we get to a positive cash flow. This is just a sum of let me be clear here. This is 162.5 is just a sum of section 3 here, the financing activities. But it's a positive 162.5 million in additional cash provided by these financing activities. Okay. And then the last section, section 4, is just a summary of everything that we've done here before. And the intent is to go from what you had at the beginning of the year, recognize what the impact of these three operating activities, long-term investing activities, and financing activities had during 2011, and then see where they stand at the end of the year. So you start beginning balance, you look at the activity, and then you have your ending balance. And so here, line R, shows basically it just adds up the sums of sections 1, 2, and 3. So it adds negative 2.5 to negative 230 to positive 162.5, and it comes up with a negative $70 million cash flow for 2011. So that's what you see here on R. That's what happened during 2011. So then on line S, it says, okay, what were your cash, what's your cash balances at the beginning of the year? How much cash did Allied Food Products have on hand on January 1st of 2011? They had $80 million cash on hand. And the final sum here is just, if you had 80 at the beginning of the year and took away 70 over the course of the year due to these different activities, then at the end of the year, the company only has $10 million in cash and equivalent, where it started the year at $80 million. So if I were just looking at this financial statement without looking at the income statement or the balance sheet, it's only giving us a perspective on what's going on with cash flows, not what's going on with income, or not what's going on with the asset structure of the business. But if we just looked at cash flows, I would say 2011 wasn't a really great year for Allied Food Products. They had a negative cash flow of $70 million during the year. So unless this extra property, plant, and equipment that they purchased throughout the year starts earning them more and more money in future years, it's going to be pretty difficult because they're not going to be able to stand another negative $70 million cash flow year, because at the end of 2011, they only have $10 million left in cash. Okay. All right. So this is a nice schematic of the cash flow statement.
But had they not bought the equipment, they would be a positive $240 million, right?
Correct. Yes. But then, you know, so then, yes, that is true. So if they didn't buy the property, plant, equipment worth $230 million and everything else stayed the same, then this number down at the bottom would be a positive $240 million. But then you would just sort of look at where most of that positive cash flow is coming from. And if you see, it's basically coming from financing here, the $220 million of financing on lines M and M. So then you might ask the question, okay, well, why did you increase the amount that you're borrowing by $220 million? You know, what was your purpose to do that? So, but yes, that's true. If they wouldn't have purchased the property, plant, and equipment, then, and everything else stayed the same, then it would be a big positive in cash flow for the year.
So they only ended up with $10 million, so that's the manager's fault.
What was that last part?
Since they only ended up with $10 million, that's the manager's fault.
No, well, it's they made decisions, and it looks like they're deciding to invest in assets that are going to be around for a long time, and they're getting loan money to do that. And so if their objective was to increase their cash flow for the year, then they would not have been successful. But if their objective was to buy property, plant, and equipment to try to make themselves more profitable in years to come, then, you know, you could say, okay, it looks like that's what they're doing.
So it looks like they're trying to expand.
Yeah, that would be my expand or replace existing equipment. Yeah. All right, so that's the statement of cash flows. And this is, so just, you know, again, I highly recommend that you go through, you look at this again on your own and go through each of these letters and read the explanations here to really help sort of cement what's going on there for you. This is definitely the most involved and complex financial statement that we'll be dealing with in this class. And after chapter 3, we won't work with this too much. And so your pain will be limited. We'll be doing a lot of work with income statements and balance sheets, but not so much with statement of cash flows or the next financial statement we're going to cover, which is the statement of stockholders' equity. So, but you do need to understand this to be able to do do one of the problems in chapter 3. So, go ahead. All right, the last financial statement we'll cover in chapter 3 here is the statement of stockholders' equity, which is on page 72 in my edition of the book. And if you recall from financial accounting, you probably worked with something called a statement of owner's equity, which is what they have for a private company. Statement of stockholder's equity is used when you have a company that has publicly traded stock, because then you have thousands of shares which represent the ownership of a business. And so you have to break it down by shares, or have to at least include shares in your calculation of stockholders' equity. So again, we're dealing with the year of 2011. And so statement of stockholders' equity starts with all the balances at the end of the previous fiscal year, which is December 31st, 2010. So this is where everything stood at the end of the previous year. They had 50,000 shares of stock outstanding. The par value of that stock is $130 million. And then we go over here to retained earnings. So let me talk about retained earnings real briefly. So,
quick question.
Yep.
What is the difference between stock and shares?
Well, shares of stock, that's the denomination, but there is no difference between shares and stock.
I know, because they use stock sometimes and they use shares sometimes in the book.
Yep.
And so it just totally confused me.
Yeah, no, they're just shares of stock. That's the way I think about it. Yeah. So the retained earnings here, retained earnings essentially is the amount, if we go back to table 3.1, let me see if I can do that real quick. And table 3.1, I think, is listed under week number 4. Yeah. Just so I can show you these retained earnings. Here we go. Okay. Let me download this. Okay. So this is the income statement that we went over last week for Allied Food Products. And if you see here, one of the entries under common equity is retained earnings. And retained earnings essentially is what's left over after a profitable company distributes dividends to shareholders. So let's see here. Where is it? Now, it doesn't really show it, but you can see here that in 2010, they had $750 million of retained earnings. And retained earnings essentially, as I said, are the amount of profits that is retained by the company after they distribute dividends. And the company will retain these profits to buy new manufacturing facilities, to invest in capital equipment and assets, and to do to finance other activities basically that allow the company to grow. So this is the amount of money that they keep in check. They don't distribute all their profits during the year. They keep some back for the company so that they can invest it in these things, which will hopefully make the company more profitable in the future. So they started out 2010 with $750 million. Oh, here's what I wanted to get to. So again, in 2011, we saw that they had $117.5 million of income. And of that, they distributed 57.5 back to the shareholders in the form of dividends. So what was left over was $60 million. And all of that goes into retained earnings. And you can see here that the equation for the addition to retained earnings is just net income minus all of your dividends for the year. And so that gets us to 60. So
60 plus that 57 gives you that 117.5.
Right. Yes. And the 60 is what's going to be added to the retained earnings based on the activities of 2011. And so if we go back, let me get here. Oops. What I wanted to do. Go back to this. Oops. common stock, you can see the beginning of the year, or at the end of 2010, which is the beginning of 2011, they had a $750 million retained earning balance. Based on 2011 net income, of which they made 117.5, they distributed 57.5 of that in cash dividends. So again, the difference here is 60 million. And so what happens is that 60 million, right here, 60, is added to the previous balance at the end of 20, oh, yes. It's added to this balance, the 750, which is the retained earnings, plus this 130, which is the par value of stock. Both of those things together represent the common equity for this company. And so if you total those up, that makes 880 million, the end of 2011, and then you add the 60 million that they added to that. And so at the end of 2011, their balance is $940 million in retained earnings. Okay. Of total stockholders' equity. Whereas at the beginning of the year, it was 880. So the only difference there is the $60 million that they decided to keep in the company and retain there. So that gets you to 940. And that's essentially what the shareholders, the total amount that the shareholders own of this particular company is the amount of the par value of the stock, which is 130 million, plus all the retained earnings. So that's what those owners have a claim to. If this business should declare bankruptcy, this is the amount that the owners would attempt to claim for their shares.
Yeah, so in essence, those managers did what they were supposed to do, was increase the value of stockholders' shares or equity, whatever?
This shows that the amount of stockholders' equity at the beginning of the year, 880, increased to 940 at the end of the year. So yeah, that's essentially what it's showing, is that the retained earnings in the business caused that increase from 880 to 940.
Kind of like a savings?
It's a little bit like a savings. Retained earnings, they're maintained by the business essentially as a safety net or for investments in equipment and things like that to allow the business to grow or continue to function. Because a business basically can't distribute all of its profits back out to its shareholders, or it won't have anything extra to invest in equipment and things like that.
So it's always going to be like that then?
What do you mean always? Well, assuming they're
profitable. They're always going to have that money there.
This total here, the 940?
At the year's end, the money they're going to put back into the business?
Uh-huh.
No matter what figure that is, that's always going to be there?
Well, assuming that they don't distribute all of their profits back to their shareholders in the form of dividends, they'll be adding something to retained earnings. If the business isn't profitable, though, they won't be adding anything to retained earnings because they don't have anything to add. So in this case, it's occurring because the business was profitable to the tune of 117.5, and they only distributed part of that 117.5 back to shareholders. So whatever's left over gets retained by the company and retained earnings. So this is a short and sweet financial statement here, statement of stockholders' equity. It's pretty straightforward. Obviously, you have to have completed your income statement prior to being able to do your statement of stockholders' equity. Typically, the financial statements are done in an order. They'll do the balance sheet first, assuming they were doing this manually, which never happens anymore. All of this is automated now. But they'd be doing they'd have to do the balance sheet first. Then they do the income statement. Then they do the cash flow statement. And finally, they can do the statement of stockholders' equity. So,
can you say that again?
Balance sheet first, income statement second, statement of cash flows third, And then statement of stockholders' equity would be the last one they do. All right. Any questions about this financial statement, statement of stockholders' equity? Okay. We're going to jump to chapter four, but why don't we do that after we take our break, mid-class break here. So let's take a break a little bit early right now. Be back in 10 minutes, and we're going to start, I'm going to start teaching you guys how to do some of the financial calculations out of chapter four. So, and this will be one thing I'll reiterate and emphasize right now. You need Microsoft Excel to do these calculations and definitely to do the calculations in chapter five. So if there's going to be a challenge for you getting access or being able to use Microsoft Excel, let me know sooner than later, because it hasn't come up too much in the past, but there have been a couple students who have tried to use other products or financial calculators to do some of these things, and it really just doesn't work well. So if for some reason you don't think you can, you'll have access to Excel, contact me now, because we'll need to figure something out one way or the other to get you access to Excel to work on these.
Yeah, just a heads up that students don't have Excel. I went out and bought the Microsoft Office program, but I didn't have to because the college offers it for free.
Yeah, who did you contact at the college to get that, David?
I actually bought mine before I found that out, so I kind of like lost out on it. But afterwards, I found out that I don't know who to contact, but they will give it to you for free.
Yeah, I tried that, to do that with mine, but I have the Mac, and they said they don't have a license to try to
for the Mac
to put like Microsoft Word. And
oh, okay. That. But they could if it was like a
they could
Windows.
Yeah, if it was a Windows.
Okay. Who did you talk to?
Randall.
Okay. Yeah. So it sounds like if you're using a computer with Windows on it, that you are able to get a free copy of Microsoft Office. Unfortunately, it doesn't sound like if you're using a Mac that is supported or that they have that product for that. So, but you can check with IT here on main campus, and they should be able to get you information on that. All right, let's take a break here. Rachel, it looks like you have somebody showing off there. I don't mind a little entertainment during break. That's fine for me.
Yeah, that's my oldest son, Shane.
Oh, yeah. All right. Doing some dancing. All right. All right. Let's see, 604. Okay, so we'll get back going here. And right now we're going to start covering some of the financial calculations. There are basically 10 financial calculations in Chapter 4 that we're going to cover. And I don't know, I don't think we'll get to all of them tonight. And so I'll let you know at the end. Basically, as far as we get tonight, there's going to be an assignment, and it's only going to cover the ratios that we get through tonight. Sort of just like, I guess, last week for Chapter 3 assignment. What we cover in class, I will, this week, I will update Canvas with what parts of the assignment will be due for next week. And then after we cover the rest of the financial calculations in Chapter 4, then the rest of the assignment will be due the following week. So just an FYI, that's sort of what we're going to do tonight. So if under week 5, what I'm going to be using, let me share my screen here. What I'm going to be using out of week 5 is a document called Blank Financial Calculations Worksheet. So, and if you want to if you want to use that for your notes tonight, what I'm going to do is, as I go through each of these financial calculations, I'm going to type out what the equation is to figure it out, and then we're going to use the Allied Food Products balance sheet and income statement that we covered last week to actually do the calculations themselves. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do each of the calculations based on 2010 numbers. And then right after that, I'm going to ask you guys, the class, to do calculations on 2011. And bless you. Bless you. And this is just really, again, to give you guys a chance to practice here in class on some of these before you actually do these on your assignment at home. So I'm just going to go through from, again, we'll start with the current ratio and just go down the list here. Again, there are 10 of these financial ratios that we'll be covering in the class. We'll just see how far we can get tonight with these. So I'm going to start with the current ratio. So these first two ratios that we're going to be working with are essentially considered liquidity ratios. And liquidity is the measure, it's a measure of how easy you can turn your assets into cash. So the more easy that you can turn, the easier it is to turn your assets into cash, the better current ratio and the better quick ratio that you'll have. And I'll explain that a little bit more here after I put the equation down for this. So the first one is the current ratio. And basically what this measures is the ability of the company to pay its bills over the next 12 months. So with its current assets and its current liabilities. And so that's exactly what this compares. So the equation here for the current ratio is current assets divided by current liabilities. So where am I going to find these numbers, current assets and current liabilities? Which financial statement am I going to be using?
Assets would be like your cash, right?
Yep. So where do I find the amount of cash in the corporation?
Income statement?
Nope. These both would be in the balance sheets. So if you look at table 3-1, which is what we're going to be using for our numbers here, you'll find both, you'll find assets, liabilities, and equities in the balance state or the balance sheet. So that's what we're going to look at here. And so I will do, we'll do 2010 first, because we can do these calculations for both years. And so if we look back at this, current assets divided by current liabilities, if I look on the balance sheet for 2010 of Allied Food Products, I see that the total current assets are $810 million. Okay. So the first thing I'm going to do here, oops, it's not that, is to take $810 million. Those are my current assets, and I'm going to be dividing those by current liabilities. So we go down here, and we have a list of current liabilities here. And then they have a total. Total current liabilities here for 2010 is $220 million. So I'm going to put $220 million there. And by the way, you don't have to add all the zeros to these as long as your answer if you say something literally, if you type it like that in your quest or in your equation or your answer, that's fine. As long as I know what you're talking about, but don't just put 220 because that is not the correct answer. So 810 divided by 220 million. That seems high, actually. Just a second. 810, 200. Okay, I guess that's right. And so that calculation is going to give you your current ratio. So I'm just going to do that in the calculator here because it's pretty easy. 810 divided by 220 gives us this answer, 3.68, et cetera, et cetera. So one thing as we do these calculations in chapter 4 and 5, all of your answers need to be to two decimal places. So in this case, and you need to round to those that two second decimal place. In this case, it'd be 3.68. No rounding necessary. So the current ratio in 2010, we'll make this. And by the way, I'm going to save this document after tonight and post it to Canvas so you can look at it and have it for your notes too, is 3.68. So what I'd like you to do now is to do the calculations for 2011. Using the same table 3.1 here. Yeah, so, and this, table 3.1 is in Canvas under week number 4, so you can open it up from there. I think it says table 3.1 and 3.2, but that will get you to it. Make sure here.
What page is that in the book?
Well, in my edition, it's page 62. It'll be in chapter 3 one way or the other, under table 3.1, so.
Chapter 3.
And then when you get your answer, why don't you just send me a little Zoom message, and I'll give you a couple minutes to do this. Send me a Zoom message and let me know what you got, and then I can respond, let you know if you got it right.
Okay. You did 2010?
Yep. Yeah, and you guys are going to do 2011.
Okay, so in my book, I got 2016, 2015, so I would do 2016.
Yeah, I would use the one off of week 4, David. That way you're making sure that you're using the exact same numbers in years as we are. And just open that up in one of your windows.
Like, see this is the 810, mm-hmm. And then... Did you look over here or did you look over here?
No, yeah. So I looked over here.
Then we're looking over here.
Yeah. So you have a different edition too. So it looks like the numbers are the same. So you should be fine.
But I'm looking here.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Steve, can you send me a message so I can send you the answer back, please?
Could you send me a request so I can send you the answer back?
I'm sorry. Could you say that again, Doris?
Could you send me a message so I can send you the answer back? I'm not really sure how to do it.
Oh, sure. Yeah, you can either reply to the message or you can click on participants, manage participants at the bottom of the screen. And then I think you can just double click on somebody's name and send them the message that way.
Send it through the chat or the number?
Yeah, through the Zoom group chat thingy. I think we have a few correct answers, but I have to actually crank the numbers here real quick.
Mm-hmm. Okay, when you divided, you divided by 228 million.
Yes, correct. Yeah, current assets divided by current liabilities. Right. Oops.
What are our answer at?
In the Zoom group chat. So just the chat function of Zoom. Yep. Looks like we got about 5 correct answers, except for some rounding, but I'll talk about that in a second. Yeah, everybody who sent me an answer so far has gotten it right. So I'll give you another minute and then I'll just run through it.
How do we send it? Hit enter?
Yep. Just type in your message and hit enter.
Did you get mine?
I did. That one's not correct. So let me show you what I did here. Not sure how to message you either. So to message, just here, I'm still sharing, good. If you go down here to manage participants at the bottom of your window, everybody's name will come up. You should just be able to, if you click on my name and then, I can't text myself. If you click on my name and then click on more and then just click chat, that'll send a message to me.
Our current assets 1,000, current liabilities 310.
Yep, I believe so. Yeah, so for 2011, the second year, 1,000 million. I'm not going to write out million, but basically 1,000 divided by 310, it gives you 3.225 million, which rounds up to 3.23 million. So that would be the answer to that one. Okay.
And yeah, I redid it again. I got 3.22, so I must have hit the wrong button.
Yep. Okay. All right. So that's how you figure out current ratio. That's pretty straightforward. Any questions about that one?
Yeah, how do you round up? Because since that third digit is a 5, or yeah. How do you do that again?
Yeah, so rounding, anything 5 or above, you round up. So 3.225 turns into 3.23.
Tell me you know more this fucking asshole. He's getting his BA.
Oh, wait. Doris, you're not muted. Um, So to round down, basically if it's 3.224 or less, then you're going to just leave it as 3.22. So that's, yeah. And everything will be rounded, we'll be doing to the second decimal place here. Okay. All right, so that that's the first ratio we're going to work on. The second one is a quick ratio, which is also a liquidity ratio. It's very similar to the current ratio with one small difference. And so let me show you the equation for it, and then let me tell you why it's different. So this also starts with current assets up top, and then we divide that. Actually, I did that wrong. Starts out with current assets up top, but we're also taking away inventories. So we're taking the inventories out of the current assets. Inventories are one of the current assets. And then we're dividing the whole thing, just like we did above, by current liabilities. Okay. So the difference here is that in the denominator in the top here, we're removing inventories from current assets. So the calculation for this for 2010, get it out of bold here, is we're going to have 810 million, which is our total current assets, right? 810 minus, let's see here, minus inventories, which is 415 here. So we're going to take 415 out of there and then divide it by current liabilities, which is going to be the same as we did the first time, 220. So, and that's going to give us our quick ratio. And the reason that they take inventories out for the quick ratio, and this is just a little bit different way of looking at measuring liquidity, but the inventories typically of all of your current assets are the ones that take the longest to turn into cash. You basically have to sell through your inventories to turn it into cash, whereas things like cash is already cash. Your accounts receivable are amounts that you've already sold and are just waiting to collect on the cash on the sale. But inventories are something that's in inventory you haven't sold yet. And so until you sell and until after that, until you collect the cash, it's not going to have a positive impact on your liquidity. And so the quick ratio is sort of a higher level of, a higher, more stringent level of measuring liquidity than the current ratio. And so in this case, then, I haven't done the math on this one, so let's do that. So we take 810, we subtract 415, that gives us 395, and we divide that by 220. It gives us a current ratio of 1.795, so we're going to round up there to 1.80. Okay, so that's the quick ratio for 2010. And you can see, this isn't million, but these are both mislabeled, by the way. Current ratio and quick ratio are not a measure of money. It's a measure, it's a ratio of to an asset to a liability. And so for these, current ratio and quick ratio, you don't need to put dollar signs or days or anything like that. They can just be, the answer can be left just in decimal format like this. Some of the other ones we're going to be working with here are going to involve percent or days or dollars or things like that. But the quick ratio and the current ratio don't. So these would be the correct way to reflect those answers. All right, so can you guys do the second set here for, in my edition, 2011 for the quick ratio? And then message me those answers. Okay, just to let you know, I'm going to unshare my screen when I'm actually working on these. So I will reshare when I'm done. But if you can bring up that table on your own computer, table 3.1, that would probably be helpful. But here is this. So far, I don't think we've gotten any correct responses on this one yet.
I got it. Now I have to do it. Show it.
Oh, see?
Right. I don't know what I did wrong. I had it. Had the idea. I don't know what I did wrong. I don't know how to really. Did you get my little message?
When I'm sharing, it's sort of hard to see the messages. So let me.
Angel, you know how to message him?
Yeah, I just don't.
Can you show me?
Okay. Well, we got two correct answers, I think. All right, so I'm going to show you what I did here. So the answer is 1.24, and basically we're taking our current assets in 2011 of 1,000, subtracting the inventories of 615, and then dividing by that same current liabilities that we used up here for the current ratio of 310. And that gets us to 1.24 for the quick ratio. So one of the things that you should definitely note is that your current ratio will always be higher than your quick ratio, because the current ratio keeps all the current assets in the denominator up top, whereas the quick ratio removes inventories. And so the quick ratio should always be lower than the current ratio for the same business in the same period of time. And I guess this gets to one question. One of the things, you need to know a few things about these ratios, just understand them. And one of them is whether a larger or a smaller number is a good thing. In some of the ratios we're going to be using, you'll actually, a smaller number is better. For the current ratio and quick ratio, what do you think? Is a smaller or a larger current ratio or quick ratio better? What are we looking for? Yell it out or shout it out, whatever. Would it be better if we had a smaller current ratio or a larger one?
Larger.
Yeah, we're actually looking for larger, and the reason being is because we have our, what these ratios are doing is it's comparing our current assets to our current liabilities, and we want more current assets than current liabilities, because that means that we'll be able to pay, we should be able to pay off our current liabilities using our current assets. So essentially, anything greater than one is somewhat positive in these. So then, because that means that you have more current assets than current liabilities, so you'll probably be able to pay those bills. If you have a current ratio or a quick ratio that's below one, then especially a current ratio below one, then you have to start asking yourself, well, how am I going to pay for these liabilities they're due in the next year if I don't have enough current assets to do so? And at that point, as a manager, you may need to look at doing something like selling some of your non-current assets, like a building or equipment or things of that nature, so that you can pay your bills that are going to be due in the next 12 months, which are your current liabilities. So for both of these ratios, higher the better, essentially. And one of the things that financial analysts and other companies will do is they'll compare the current ratios for companies in the same industry. For instance, maybe they'll compare Microsoft and Google for their software platforms, and they'll say, okay, which of these two companies has a better current ratio? And they'll make some evaluations based on that. And so that's one of the ways that they could use it. They could compare it company to company. But the other thing they can do is they can also use these ratios to compare a company's current ratio with the average for that industry. So let's say it's Google and you want to compare the current ratio to other similar technology companies, the average of those companies. And so you can compare it to the average and see how Google is doing just with regards to the average of the industry. Or you can compare it with specific companies or companies that are high performers in the industry. And if they're comparing these numbers to the high performers, that's considered comparing benchmarks. So typically, they're either going to compare these ratios to a benchmark, which are the high performers, or the average of the industry, just to get a sense for how this company is doing in relation to other companies in the industry, similar companies. Okay. All right, so those are the first two calculations we're going to do, current ratio and quick ratio. And really, both of those, to some degree, tell us how able a company is going to be to pay its bills in the next 12 months. Okay. Number three on the list.
So you said it's better to have a lower ratio?
No, higher ratio. Higher ratio? Yeah. So the inventory turnover ratio is the next one we'll look at. And inventory turnover and days sales outstanding, these two ratios or calculations are considered asset management ratios because they look at how a company uses its assets. In the case of number three here, it looks at how well a company uses its inventory or how quickly it sells through its inventory. And number four, days sales outstanding, will look at how well a company uses its accounts receivable asset. So we'll start here with inventory turnover ratio. And again, this is a measure of how quickly a company sells through its inventory. The quicker, the better, really. A company doesn't want to be holding a bunch of inventory that it takes a long time to sell through, because that's a lot of capital, a lot of money tied up that they're not making any sales off of that until they actually sell it. Excuse me. And so the quicker that a company sells through its inventory without running out of stock, which is sort of the balance there. You don't want to maintain such a low inventory level that you sell out of things, so you lose sales. But the quickest, barring that, the quickest a company can turn over its inventory, sell through its inventory, the better. That's the most efficient thing for a company. So the way that we calculate this is by taking net sales and dividing that by inventories. So for this particular calculation, we're going to need to pull from two different financial statements. So the inventories are in the balance sheet. Where do I find net sales? What financial statement am I going to look for net sales? But which financial statement am I looking at?
Income statement of year end ending.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, the income statement. So that's where I'm going to find net sales. And if we look here in 2010, the net sales were, this is basically $2.85 billion because this is in millions of dollars here. So we're going to say $2,850 are the net sales in 2010. So we'll take that and we'll do $2,850 and we'll divide that by the amount of inventories. How much inventories do they have at the end of 2010? For Allied Food Products. We use this one actually for the quick ratio already.
415,
yes. So 415 from the balance sheet. We see inventories are 415 in 2010. So we plug that in there. Take out gold. And this is our calculation for inventory turnover ratio. So if we do this, 850 divided by 415, we get 6.867, which rounded up is 6.87. And 6.87. And what this means is that the company essentially has sold through its level of inventory almost seven times throughout the course of the year, right? Because their sales were 2850 and what they have in inventory is 415. And so they had to replenish their inventory almost seven times throughout the year to be able to sell that much product. So that's their inventory turnover ratio for 2010. So if you can work on the inventory turnover ratio now for 2011. I'm going to unshare my screen while I calculate this real quick here. Okay, looks like we have a bunch of correct answers. Excellent. Everyone's gotten it right so far. All right, so let me show you. Those of you who haven't submitted something yet. So this is the calculation for 2011. So the net sales in 2011 was, in the income statement here, 3,000, 3 billion, essentially. And we divide that by the inventory level in 2011, which we look at the balance sheet and we see is 615. So that leaves us with an inventory turnover ratio in 2011 of 4.88. So would you say that if we looked at the year-to-year comparison here between 2010 and 2011, which was the best year for this company for inventory turnover ratio? Which number's better, essentially?
2010.
2010, yes. The higher inventory turnover ratio. So they sold through their inventory more times, which means they're more efficiently using their inventory to make sales in 2010 at 6.87, because in 2011, they turned over less than five times. So they use their inventory less. And it was mostly...
If you have too much inventory, doesn't that cost money?
Yes, exactly. That's why you want a higher inventory turnover ratio. You want to have as many sales as you can get with as low an inventory level as possible. So the two ways that you can increase your inventory turnover ratio is to either increase sales and keep your inventories the same, or to keep your sales same and decrease your inventories. And essentially you want to increase sales or decrease inventories to improve this ratio, right? All right, so that's inventory turnover ratio. That's the first asset management ratio. The second one is the days sales outstanding. And essentially what days sales outstanding measures is how well a company is using its accounts receivable. And so the equation for days sales outstanding is accounts receivable, the balance at the end of the year, divided by net sales, divided by 365. And so what this is doing here is it's taking your accounts receivable balance, which is what your customers owe you. You've sold, but you've extended them credit. And it divides that by an average daily sale. So that's what net sales divided by 365 does. It gives you an average sales per day. Because what the ratio here will give you at the end of the day is the number of days sales that you have to collect on, which is days sales outstanding. So the way that this calculation then goes for 2010, off the bold, so we look at our account receivable balance here in 2010 is 315. So that's going to be in the denominator here, 315.
This is on the income statement, right?
Accounts receivable is on the balance sheet. The net sales is on the income statement. Yeah. And this is one of the other things that you can do. If you're working through all these ratios, you see that it's asking for net sales here again. You can just, you don't have to go back to the financial statement if you already have it here from the previous problem, your inventory turnover ratio. So we're just going to take it from here, 2850. You can confirm it if you want to look at the income statement, but that's what it is. So 2850 divided by 365. And so this is what we need to do to figure this out. It's probably going to be a two-step process unless you're using Excel to do this, because you need to figure out what's in the I'm trying to think of denominator and numerator, and I was confused. So you have to do the calculation in the brackets first, and then you can take this. So if we go 315, and then we divide that by, nice thing about Excel is you can put this all in one cell, and it'll calculate it for you. But we'll work on that soon. We take 2850, we divide by 365. That gives us their average daily sales. Average daily net sales, which is 7.80 or 7.81 if we round up. So 7.81, and we do this finally. 315 divided by 7.81. That gives us 40.33. And this, for day sales outstanding, the correct labeling is days. So whatever you get out of this calculation, it's going to be days. So what this means is that in 2010, at the end of 2010, Allied Food Products had a little over 40 days sales outstanding in accounts receivable. So that meant on average, what they sold through 40 days was their accounts receivable balance. So do you think on day sales outstanding, we want a higher or lower number? Which is better?
Lower, because then it takes less days for it to get paid off.
Yes, lower because we essentially have extended less credit, and so we have less to collect on in the future. So, yeah, you want a lower days sales outstanding, everything else being equal. All right, so why don't you guys do 2011, the other year. All right, we got four. One, two, three, four, five. Five correct answers and one incorrect one so far. All right. No, Diane, yours was correct. Sure. Yes. All right. So this is what I did for my 2011 calculation. We took accounts, they had an accounts receivable balance of $375 million, had net sales of $3 billion, and divided by 365. So again, I did this in a two-step process. 375, did this part, calculation first, came up with 8.22 after I divided 3,000 by 365. And then I went over here, and 375 divided by that is 45.62 days. So are they doing better or worse in 2011 with regards to their day sales outstanding?
Worse.
What's that?
Worse.
Worse, correct. Yes. Yeah, it's taking them longer to collect on sales, essentially. They have more accounts receivable in comparison to what they sold during the year. So 2010, they were doing better than 2011. Again, for day sales outstanding, less is more. Okay.
Where did the days come from?
The days represent the average. So this, the portion in the denominator here, the bottom, this gives you your average sales per day, which is 7.81 for 2010. And so the days just mean that you have 40 days of sales at this average rate of 7.81 that you still need to collect on. So it's the average equivalent of what you have in accounts receivable. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So the 3,000 divided by 365, it gives us those days?
It gives you your average sales per day, which is this 8.22. So that's if you sold the exact same amount every day throughout the year, you'd sell 8.22 million per day. And so you divide that into your accounts receivable balance, and that tells you on average how many days of sales you still need to collect on.
Hey, David, this is called a day sales outstanding equation.
Yes.
So that's why this equation would end in days.
Yes, correct. Yep. Yeah, and certain, you know, the more a company extends credit to its clients, the more important it is for them to have a good day of sales outstanding. Some companies, you know, maybe they don't extend any credit to their clients, so they're not going to be worried about this particular financial ratio at all because it's probably going to be zero. But for other companies that do extend credit, and this one especially actually in the healthcare field is really important for hospitals and healthcare providers who rely on insurance reimbursements because they have to wait typically a long time before they get paid by the insurance company. And so one of the measures of billing departments at hospitals and clinics is how low this number is. It's so important to them to keep this number low because if they don't push the insurers to reimburse them for these services that they build, the amount that they have in receivables could grow pretty dramatically. So, yeah. So it's depending on the industry, this particular financial ratio is more or less important. And it all really depends on how much credit they extend to their clients. Okay. So the next the debt ratio and the times interest earned ratio are both considered debt management ratios, which essentially measures how well a company uses money that is loaned to it or has credit extended to it. And this is similar to the current ratio, except instead of using current assets and current liabilities, we use all assets and all liabilities. So the equation for the debt ratio is total debt. Make this bold here. Total debt, which is the same thing as total liabilities, right? So we know what we're, those mean the exact same thing, divided by total assets. That's the equation. So which financial statement are we going to look at to find these pieces of information before we start here? Income statement, balance sheet, cash flow.
Balance sheet.
Balance sheet, yes. Yeah. You'll find all your assets and all your liabilities on the balance sheet. So let's do 2010 here. We go to 2010 and we're looking for total liabilities. We go down here to this liabilities and equity section. They give us our total current liabilities, and then they have long-term bonds, which is the only long-term liability, and then total debt. So total debt here is 800 million in 2010. So that's gonna be in the numerator here. And the denominator, total assets, right here, 1680. So it's gonna be our total assets. Yeah, it's pretty simple math here. 800 divided by 1680 is 0.476. Again, we're doing this to two decimal places. So here it would be 0.48 as the debt ratio. And this is sometimes described in decimal fashion like this, or, whoops, not plus, or sometimes expressed like as a percent. So you can either submit it in decimal form like this, or you can convert it to a percent like this. So 0.48 or 48%, either of those would be fine for the debt ratio. Okay. So you guys do 2011. You can, no, you can do it either way. A decimal or a percent is fine. Yeah. I should put or there, I guess. Holy cow, you guys are raining down the correct answers tonight. Good job. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So far, all the answers I've gotten are correct. Excellent. Wow, we're running out of time here, too. I guess this will be our last one. Okay, so yes, 0.53 or 53% would be the correct answer for 2011. You have 1,060 in total debt, and you have 2,000 in total assets. So that would give you 0.53 or 53%. So for this, the debt ratio, is it better to have a lower or a higher debt ratio?
Lower.
Lower, correct. Lower the better. In most cases, because it's comparing your debt to your total debt to your total assets. This is actually a ratio that is especially for businesses looking for financing and loans, existing businesses, banks will want to look at this debt ratio to determine how leveraged a company already is. And by leverage, I just mean how much financing they have in comparison to their total assets. So the lower, the better for the debt ratio.
So would 0.50 be average? No, never mind.
Nope. Okay. So we've got through, we got 5 minutes left. So I'm just going to wrap it here for these. And so we've gotten through the first five ratios here of the 10, which is pretty good, actually. I'm pretty happy with that. And so if you go to, and I'm going to update this tomorrow in Canvas, but if you go to Canvas and under week five, we have, so a few things for assignments next week. Finish up the problems 3-3, 3-4, 3-7, and 3-10. That'll be due, all of those will be due next Tuesday because we've covered those now. No, that's chapter three problems, yeah. And then for...
is this not part of chapter three assignments?
No, what I'm going to... The calculations that we're doing right now are out of chapter four. So all of this information that we covered on the financial calculations tonight is out of chapter four. So... the assignment, what I'm going to ask you to do, and I'll update this, actually I'll update it right after class tonight, is there's a Bellingham Herald financial statement here. So if you open up this under assignments, this is a fake financial statement. I just created this. Oh, I need to update it too. Yeah, I need to update that file. So what I'm going to do is I will update this assignment, and I'll just ask you to do the first five financial ratios for the Bellingham Herald financial statements. And if you open this up, what you'll get is you'll get an income statement and a balance sheet. And that will those will be the two financial statements you'll need, obviously, to complete ratios one through five. So, but I need to update those financial statements too because I looks like I missed a few things. So let me do that. And then tomorrow I'll send an email out to everyone when these have been updated. And then you can get the assignment for next week in addition to these problems. And like I said, the other thing I'll have by the end of the week is there will be a essay assignment on the tribal legal and taxation resources that we covered last week. So there will be 2 to 3 essay questions for that, that will be due on Tuesday. So you'll have 3 or 4 days to complete those also. So I'd recommend starting on, definitely if you haven't finished the chapter three problems here, do those and then move on to these financial ratios for next week. And I'll have these updated and the class video posted by tomorrow afternoon for you.
Are chapter three questions, do they concern a spreadsheet?
Only if you use a spreadsheet to create those draft financial statements to help you work through the problems. Yeah.
Otherwise, they can be solved with a calculator?
Yeah, they can be solved with a calculator. But like I said, I would recommend that you put together a draft, very simple draft financial statement with the information that they give you in each one of those four problems so that you can solve what they're looking for. You're basically solving for a missing item in each of those. So you can use Excel or you can do it, you know, you can create those in paper or Word or something like that too. All right. Any other questions? Kathleen. All right. Well, if not, have a good week. Like I said, I'll email out to everyone tomorrow once I have the assignments updated. And then look for those essay questions by Friday.
Okay. Which one works better, the current ratio or the click ratio?
They're just different ways of looking at the same thing, really. The current ratio, the click ratio is a more stringent measure of liquidity because it takes out the inventories. And so the only thing you're operating with for your assets are all your current assets minus the inventories. With the current ratio, or that was the quick ratio. With the current ratio, you're using all of your current assets. And so you can get a higher number with current ratio, obviously, than you can with a quick ratio. It's somewhat dependent on how much your company relies on selling from inventories. You know, if it doesn't rely on selling from inventories that much, then a current ratio is probably a better measure. But if you're in like a production business where you're producing equipment or gadgets or things like that, then the quick ratio would be better because then you're relying on your inventory to pay bills. More on your inventory to pay bills. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
So these essay questions you're speaking of, those are for the midterm?
Yes, those will be part of the midterm, yeah, the take-home part. Yeah. And I'll have those posted by Friday. All right. Thank you all. Have a good week. Email me if you have any questions.